What's going on, everybody? It's Evil Eddie from Pure Evil MMA and ProWrestlingAuthority.com. I am joined today by no other than Sean Gilday from Combat Sports Nation. What's going on, Sean? How are you doing?
What's going on, my friend? How are you?
I'm doing great. Let me just pull your image in on here.
All right.
How was your weekend, man?
It was good. It was fulfilling. Some interesting fights, some interesting things happening, some tragic things, potentially could have been near fatal things have happened this past weekend in the world of mixed martial arts, and I'm sure we'll get into that regarding Bellator.
Were you able to watch the Bellator event?
I did. I caught some clips of it as well as some of the fights. I didn't actually get to see the two headlining fights, but overall, it was an interesting card.
Yeah, definitely. And we had a couple problems, and we're going to get into that in a few seconds. But first, I just want to introduce myself to everyone in case there's any new listeners out there. I'm Evil Eddie from Pure Evil MMA and ProWrestlingAuthority.com. You guys can find the podcast on iTunes. Just search Pure Evil MMA. Or actually, no, don't search that. Search ProWrestlingAuthority.com. And if you don't have an Apple, that's totally fine because we're also on Podbean.com for all my droid lovers out there. So check it out. Weekly updates. I put on a great show. I actually just interviewed Lion Fights president or CEO Scott Ken, along with a few of the fighters. Sean knows all of them. We were sitting together at Lion Fights 30, and they're coming back to the casino on the second, live on Access TV, starting at 9 p.m. I'm pretty sure, right, Sean?
Correct. The live portion, which is the amateur portion of Lion's Fight, always airs on Access TV. If you want to follow along for those fighters who have not yet made the transition to go pro, you could catch them through our Combat Sports Nation's Punch by Punch blog, Kick by Kick, however you want to consider it, Punch by Punch blog on combatsportsnation.com. We always have that to make sure that we're giving the undercard fighters or the amateurs the spotlights that they deserve. Like fighters like Brian Bogue and a couple other fighters there that definitely deserve.
Jarena Barnes has a fight coming up against Angela Whitley. If we want to talk about that first, I know there's some Muay Thai fans that love the show. So, they're coming back to Foxwoods September 2nd. Angela Whitley, I just interviewed her. You guys can subscribe down below and check those interviews out. What are we going to see come September 2nd? Have you seen either of these fighters fight before? I mean, we all know Jarena from, beating Cyborg. What do you have to say about it?
Jarena is amazing, amazing athlete, an amazing fighter. In the world of striking, she's probably one of the best in the world in her division. The last fight that I saw her live was at Lion's Fight. She dismantled her opponent. Unfortunately, I cannot remember her opponent's name. And then she had a title defense after that. I didn't see that one live. She did take a little bumps and bruises on that one, but as a champion, she persevered. And I look forward to seeing her again, in the ring back in our region in the Northeast at Foxwoods Casino.
And do you remember the very first fight of the night on the undercard? It was Roger Corbin who ended the fight in 24 seconds. Do you remember that?
I do, and the amateur.
Yes, I was able to talk to him yesterday, and I found out a lot about him, man. He's fighting this Friday on UFC Fight Pass for the U.S. Armed Forces Navy versus Air Force. That's going to be live on Fight Pass this weekend, so very excited about that. And he also has a Twitch account. You know what that is. Rampage has one. Mighty Mouse has one. They play video games, and you can interact with them. Pretty cool guy, so check that interview out as well. Lion Fights is going to be September 2nd. So, all right, let's get into Bellator because it was a crazy weekend, a great event. Did you have something you wanted to say?
Yeah, let's back up. So he was on the undercard. Is that event affiliated with Glory? Is he making
Glory,
a transition?
Yes, it's going to be Glory 32 on UFC Fight Pass. But so he was fighting for Lion Fights, yes.
As an amateur, so is he making the transition to pro, or is he also, is Glory, you know, fighting the amateurs as well?
That's a really good question. I should definitely ask him that. I'm not positive. I do know that I did not know before I did the interview that he was going to be fighting on Fight Pass. I was just impressed at that 24-second fight. So it was, you know, I kind of got lucky, you know, finding that information out in such an exciting – it's actually a super fight. Mm. And, of course, I love to support our troops. I have boys over there who listen to the podcast. And, you know, they have all of my respect. Anyone who has the courage to, you know, allow us to do – what we want, have our freedom. So check that out. UFC Fight Pass this Friday. And Roger's an awesome guy. But guys, also, I mentioned this in my post on Twitter and Facebook. John does live updates during Lion Fights. Definitely check that out. Event by event, there's not many websites doing it. I'm pretty sure the only website that does it next to, you know, me just letting everyone know who won the fight, you know?
Well, luckily, you know, that, and I appreciate you pointing that out, just as myself have, and there's many national MMA sites or even combat sports fighting networks or channels or websites that will cover whatever is televised. Because they're able to do that from the comfort of their own home. They don't have to request credentials and use the gas. So they'll go ahead and cover the events that's televised. Luckily, we're able to go to CES in Rhode Island, Lions Fight, and we'll actually go ahead and do the entire event and give those undercard fighters the exposure that they need to be able to hopefully get some notoriety to where when they go pro, people are like, man, I've heard about him or I've read about him. I want to support him.
And that's very important that, you know, there's people like us out there that do that, and especially you, you know, doing the live updates. And, you know, I would think if I, you know, followed you, you would have a couple of the fighters. Do you know if you're going to have any interviews coming up with them or?
With Lions Fight, we have a lot of programming that I'm anticipating soon. So something coming up very exciting Wednesday. It is already scheduled, not necessarily with Lions Fight, but with some big happenings of another promotion that's coming for their 32nd show, so World Series of Fighting. So I'm excited.
Nice man.
So I'm excited about that programming that we have. I like being able to be on this show with you. I think this really adds a lot of dynamic with Combat Sports Nation and with Pure Evil MMA. So we're always trying to churn the wheels to get original content. And as you know, Eddie, and as our fans know, everybody could put out a very similar story, you know, when news breaks or when a story breaks, but it's that separate content that really sets you apart from you know, competitive website. So that's our goal, is to get that exclusive, get that special to us, basically.
And before we get into Bellator, I just want to let everyone know, the Pure Evil Army know, and any new listeners out there, they can find you at combatsportsnation.com, correct?
That's correct. You know, I am the attributor there, or contributor there, and I'm always looking to grow the nation, you know, the Combat Sports Nation family. So you could find me there. You could find me on Twitter. You could find me on Instagram. Instagram is Combat Sports Nation. Eddie, of course. Twitter is Combat Sports with no vowels, Nation.
Yes.
And yeah, so, and of course, YouTube. You know, our YouTube channel is growing. You can find a lot of local fights that we were able to edit. And once again, exclusive content. And then our interviews when we're able to attend these events. And I know that we were able to share some media credentials or be right alongside of each other with media credentials at World Series. So original content, that's the biggest thing.
And what day is World Series of Fighting coming?
World Series of Fighting 32. I believe that is the second. Let's take a look. Let me just go to Combat Sports.
And where's that? That's not the one in Springfield, Massachusetts, is it?
No, it was originally in Springfield, Massachusetts. They decided not to do the show in Springfield. And the biggest reason why they decided not to do the show is they just did a show in the Northeast. And we have a very strong customer base, or a very strong committed demographic for fight fans in this area. But with so many other shows, I know World Series wanted to make sure that there was fans were not being flooded with shows in this area. So they figured to take their event somewhere else and go ahead and build up the excitement of having them return sometime further down at some point in this year. So World Series of Fighting is actually July 30th, live on NBC Sportsnet. That is in Everett, Washington. So at the Xfinity Theater, that's Marlon Moraes, Josh Hill 2. So if you don't get a chance to see their first fight, we'll have it up on our website. So you can go ahead and check that out. We'll forward it to our Facebook page, and you'll be able to see why it is that they're lining up across the cage from each other and making this happen on the 30th.
All right, so let's get into the big news of the weekend that everyone is talking about. I've been fired up about this, man. Like, I really wanted to talk to somebody about this. We were supposed to do the show earlier.
Correct.
You know, we get caught up. There's so much going on. But I was able to schedule it tonight, and here we are. It's a great time, Sunday night. So thank you for joining me first off. But let's get into Bellator, man. There was a little confusion this week. Yusuf pointed out to me that, you know, on social media, there were these updates coming up. And I was like, you know, what? Matt Mitrione lost? Matt Mitrione won? MVP won? I thought the fights were tonight at 9 p.m. or 8 p.m. Come to find out that they were they went live over there and didn't stream it until an hour after they already went live. And then 3 hours later aired it over here. So we had already figured out who had won these fights. How much of an effect do you think that played on Bellator, on the views coming in?
Oh, goodness. So how do I believe that it affected it? I am very much in line with how many and most people felt on social media. I think it was very foolish to go ahead and move or delay the airing. I understand why they did have to still tweet out the result, because they still had that the London and the European fans that wanted those updates because their friends, their families, their fighters were still competing. But I feel as if it should have just been live.
That's the point, exactly.
I just don't think they did themselves any favors as far as growing their loyalty to their brand, because people were just, it left a very poor taste in a lot of people's mouth that look, I want to see the event live. I don't want it to be spoiled. Nobody wants their movie to be spoiled.
If you're not like a diehard MMA fan, it really wouldn't matter that much, but they don't really have that right now. And, you know, for people who don't know that are watching this show, you know, let's just rewind really quick and let them know what happened in the past couple events with Bellator. You know, one thing that everyone's kind of has a problem with is the kickboxing and then the cage. That's one. I don't have a problem with it, but to try to go and get the respect from viewers competing with the UFC, you know, that kind of settles it and confuses a lot of people. One, and my biggest problem is the promotions. Of course, you know, Joe Schilling versus Cato, that's a great fight. And I didn't really see much promotion on the fight. I didn't really even know that it was after the Rampage fight. You know, what could Bellator do to get the respect from everybody that the UFC has?
And the funny thing about the event that you had just mentioned, the one prior, 157, I believe that was Dynamite 2. The thing is that they had kickboxing on the card. So one portion of the card was supposed to be MMA. The other portion was supposed to be kickboxing, but they had kickboxing bouts a part of the MMA programming. It didn't make sense. And once again, it was on delay. So I don't think they're doing any favors to their fight fans by mixing it up. Integrating kickboxing and MMA. If they were having it two completely shows, that would have been great. I think I understand why they can't do that, because the time slot that it would take to air both events would probably cost a lot of money to be on Spike TV for that amount of time. But at the same time, if you really look at it, Eddie, their full kickboxing and MMA card is pretty much the same amount of time as if it was just a full MMA card. Same amount of fights. So they didn't do, I don't think they're doing any favors for themselves by doing that.
And you know what? The thing I brought up in the show earlier today is they have such an amazing roster. Of course, Rory McDonald now is talking about maybe coming over. They have Rampage. They have, you know, Vanderlei. They have, you know, great. And of course, those are older fighters. There is your Ilwer Brooks obviously just came over from the Bellator to the UFC, and we kind of got to see that fight. They have a great roster over at Bellator, and I just think they need to work on their promotion. That's it. Because, you know, I'm always going to tune in, but I'm a loyal diehard fan of the fights and the fighters. So for them to get, you know, more views, I think some changes have to be made. But outside of that drama, there were amazing fights that night. MVP was obviously the highlight versus Cyborg. What were you thinking in that fight? And, of course, you got to see MVP when he was just over here. What were you thinking in the Cyborg fight?
You know, I really expected more, but nobody, I'm sure, expected what did happen. Or maybe the degree of the injury that was caused by what happened. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people, including myself, it was going to be a clinic on the feet, and I felt that if Cyborg was able to get it to the ground, Rampage was likely going to have no problem getting back to the feet. So, which he was successful at, Michael Page was successful at. Did I think it was going to be, dominated on the feet? It was a Michael Page show, just as we come to think of it as, but he's just climbing this ladder to where you would have thought, especially from Cyborg beating Brendan Ward in his hometown. I feel as if that the winner of that fight should have fought Page, and I thought it was going to go the way it went, but I just didn't think it was going to happen with the devastation that it did.
And for everyone who doesn't know, what happened was Michael Venom Page in the second round, I'm pretty sure, went with a flying knee and literally put a dent into Cyborg's head. I showed the clip earlier on today's show, and if you rewatch it, you just hear a huge whoa! there goes my microphone. But that's pretty much what it sounded like, man. And it literally dented his forehead. And again, another highlight reel for Michael Venom Page. Very impressive, I thought. And I was asked over the weekend, and I kind of want to get your input on this. I was asked, how would Michael Venom Page do over in the UFC? And I said, I think he's perfect over there at Bellator right now. I think for what he, his walkout, his whole, the promotion that they do, kind of with like the stage walkout and just like the presence where it's kind of in between. I think he's perfect over there and has a perfect level of competition. What do you think about this? Would he make out good in the UFC? Is he good at Bellator? What do you think over there at Combat Sports Nation?
I think he would be successful with a move to the UFC. I to keep it simple, I definitely think he would be successful. I think he's a very difficult fighter to find someone in training to emulate, regardless of what roster he's a part of. And, everybody wants to see the elite fighters in certain promotions make those moves to the next level. I agree with you that he's in a good spot, but to answer your question, how do I think he would do? I think he would do very well against what most people would say is the number one roster for welterweight in the world. So,
and of course, this kind of blends into what I'm going to be talking about in a little bit. Of course, Eddie Alvarez was champion over there. He came over to the UFC, and now he's the champion. Yep. So that worked out well for him. And what I'm going to be talking about in a little bit is, you know, no one's really talking about that. Even over there in Philly, they're not really repping that like I thought they would. The accomplishment that he has just achieved. We're going to be talking about that in a little bit. But also on this card, Matt Mitrione with his second Bellator win. I was excited to see him go in there. I didn't know it was going to happen. Were you able to watch that fight?
I did not. I was able to watch the highlights. I mean, look, it was a very experienced former NFL player against the World Strongman competition. You know, not to label him that way. That's what he is the former strongman. Britain's strongman or European strongman. He's a submission guy. A lot of success, but not at the caliber. You know, I mean, Mitrione is just a couple fights removed from one of these, you know, being competitive in the strongest heavyweight roster in the world. So, I mean, does that mean that Ole was fed to him or tossed up to him as a gimme fight? I don't think there's any gimme fights in a heavyweight division. But I just think he was outclassed going into that fight.
And, of course, he just fought like a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, under
and won that fight.
Also by knockout.
Also by knockout. But he found himself in a little trouble during that fight last time. But here he made out pretty well. And I'm looking forward to see what comes next. And, of course, they just announced Vanderlei is going to be fighting over at where is he fighting?
Risen FF.
Yeah, Risen and Risen of and someone else they announced as well.
Marco Krokop.
Yes, and Krokop. They announced Krokop. Are you going to be watching that?
I will go online. I will go ahead and search out for those matches because they have those matches in obviously real time, they air them in real time, and almost immediately as soon as they're aired, you're able to go ahead and pick them up somewhere on YouTube. So same thing I did when Ward fought over there and around New Year's and a couple other stateside fighters fought over there. I will be watching as soon as the tape or as soon tapes
as Holly soon Holm, as the Holly Holm fight
The Holly Holm fight.
Shevchenko in 5 days.
Oh, yes. And that's exciting as well. But the Risen fight, I'll definitely be looking for that. Not to jump around, but yeah, the Risen fight is actually a two-part open weight tournament. It's a 12-man tournament. There's four men that are going to get a first round, 12 or 16. I think it's a 16-man tournament.
It's a 16-man tournament.
I can go to combatsportsnation.com has that story up there. I'm just going to pull that up, just make sure that it was a 16-man. Vanderlei is one of the four men who will have a first round bye, coincidentally enough, I don't know. I think Risen is going to try to build itself through not necessarily the quality of the matchup, not sound like an asshole, but not necessarily the quality of the matchups that they're trying to create, but more so the buzz, the wow factor. Sometimes the same hole that we've seen Bellator getting into recently is not necessarily the strongest matchups, but more so the wow matchups. Even the matchups that are a little bit overdue, but fans will still watch it because of the names that are involved.
So, all right. It was an amazing event at Bellator, but let's get into the upcoming fight coming up. And then I can let you go if you're a little busy.
Oh, no, I'm here for you.
Holly Holm versus Shevchenko. And, of course, we were just line fights, and we saw her sister win the belt. Did you get to watch the UFC Road to the Octagon with Holly and Shevchenko yet? They just dropped it on YouTube.
I believe that's also edited up on Combat Sports Nation as well. Nice. I was able to see that. I mean, it's impressive. This, it, it's I like this matchup because it's not two opposing strengths. They're both incredible strikers, and I think this is going. Somebody's either going to end it very early, or this is going to be a a full fight of a striking battle. That it's going to be wizardry, if that's even a way. It's there are two wizards on the feet, and if it goes the full fight, it's going to be pleasant throughout the whole. A treat, I guess I should say.
And Muay Thai, you know, we see these fighters go in there and just destroy people, but going up against Holly Holm, you know, who kind of has that kickboxing style, it's definitely going to be a great fight, and that's coming in 5 days. Who are you favoring, if you don't mind me asking? Can I scratch your head with that?
Holmes, for sure, without a doubt. And a little bit of that has to do with my fandom. A little bit of that has to do with simply the fact of I don't fathom. I can't fathom in my mind seeing Holly Holm dropping a second fight in a row, game planning, being a part of the team that she's a part of. I just can't see her losing two fights in a row. I can't comprehend that. What do you think?
I'm going to agree with you, but I think we might find it ending in a decision. I think both these girls have enough respect for each other that I think it's going to be a decision. I'm looking forward to that, and that's only 5 days away, so definitely excited about that, especially just after seeing her sister, meeting her sister, so that was kind of cool. So, of course, I'm not giving you guys a biased pick. I'm going with Holly here, so you can trust Pure Evil MMA for an unbiased pick, which gets me into the next kind of conversation, McGregor versus Diaz 2. What do you think about that? Who do you think's going to be on top there, and what changes do you think Conor McGregor is going to have to make to win?
Well, first, I like to reinforce this. You got a lightweight fighting a featherweight at welterweight. So they could have met at lightweight, but there's, of course, Conor was like, that's where I got beat, was at welterweight. That is where we're going to make it happen again. And there's some, some pride in that, I guess, maybe that some would consider that's an issue with pride for him. I consider that as I'm not going to avenge a loss where the loss didn't happen. He wants to go ahead and avenge that loss. And I believe they're both going to come into the bout that much more prepared physically, both of them, for that weight class.
Well, we didn't really see, like, Conor, the way he would usually fight. We didn't really see him, lull you with his movements, didn't really go for the kicks. He was landing his shots, but, man, he really must have thought he was invincible because he was throwing some heavy haymakers, and then in that second round, we all know what happened. I'm very excited for this. I do not know what I think yet, though. I don't know who I'm going for. I know Conor definitely needs to make some adjustments. And to let everyone know, I've been staying up on my UFC news, and I'm sure Sean has too. Conor has brought in some lanky southpaws that are great jiu-jitsu people to come in and train with them. So, of course, that's going to be different this time because his training camp, he didn't really know he was going to be fighting Nate. He thought he was going to be fighting RDA originally. He kind of took the fight saying, I'd fight anyone. I don't care. And that kind of made it cool, but it didn't go his way. Here he is, revenging his loss. And we have Aldo, who just won, so we have that on the back burner as well. Conor really doesn't have anything to lose, except he's going to have this hanging over his head the rest of his life. But I just don't know who to pick yet.
I think if he is able to persevere and beat, I think if he's – it would be interesting. If he was able to go ahead and put – Nate Diaz away, whether it's a finish or a clear, decisive decision, then what would be exciting would be for them to meet a third time, not before he returns down a featherweight and defends that title. Yes. But it would be fun to see just to be clear, I think it would be fun to see a third fight if McGregor was to win, but that – that would or should happen at lightweight. What do you think about that? And again, we're speculating. We're going based upon if there was, you know, if they even the score at 1-1. What do you think about that?
Well, of course, you're going to have to do that because if that's what happens, that's what we've always done in the past, whether it was Frankie Edgar or GSP or BJ Penn. Everyone got their third match, you know what I mean? So, of course, they're going to want to do that because it's going to bring in so much money. So my next question for you is this going to be bigger than UFC 200 with pay-per-view buys, or maybe UFC 189, which we know broke records with, I think it was like 1.8 million it broke. What do you think? Is it going to beat UFC 200 for pay-per-view buys?
Man. I think a lot of it had to do, as far as the numbers, with the mystery of how is he going to do, going to do leveling up to 170, and the questions around how is Diaz going to perform on such short notice.
Dude, so Diaz is looking jacked right now. I don't know if you've seen him, but he looks huge.
I have seen some pictures. You know, he has the ability. Again, he's a 155-pound fighter. It's a luxury for him to be able to come in. He has a lot more ability to walk around at a higher weight because that's more natural for him than Conor has in having to get used to that. So how long did it take for Conor to actually have to get used to carrying that extra weight, as opposed to there's probably not much change that Nate has to do as far as carrying that weight, that additional. Yeah, I want to say additional, but I wouldn't say that there's really no additional weight that he's carrying. He's just able to walk around without as much stress on his body.
Even mentally as well. You know, in their last fight, he was getting beat up pretty bad in that first round. He was bleeding, and he was able to keep himself so calm. And you see that with a lot of veteran fighters, whether they're in UFC or anywhere, how calm he was able to stay. And he saw that moment, and we all saw that moment too, where everything just came. Huge momentum change with that one slap, you know?
Yeah.
And he beat the unstoppable Conor McGregor, and we watched him for years. Never thought we'd see Nate as on top of things as he was. This is huge for Nate. This is awesome. Also, his brother's coming back. Are you excited for that?
Yeah, beast mode.
Who should he fight? I've been asking everybody this. Who should he fight?
Depends. Where is he going to come back at? You know, and this is a guy, if you remember when he fought, pretty sure his last fight was Anderson Silva.
Yep, and he was laying in the octagon. He was falling asleep.
Yeah,
that was ridiculous.
I love the meme that goes with that. You know, no matter how cool you think you are, you'll never lay down. You'll never lay down in a cage in front of Anderson Silva. But he's not concerned with, and he says he's not concerned with gold. With a title, he just wants money-making fights. And since Conor, really, you didn't hear that as a constant theme from fighters. The theme was, I want gold, I want gold, I'm fighting for that gold, I want. But now, Conor has sort of changed the mindset of a lot of fighters to where they're now saying, I don't care necessarily about the title, I want the big money fights. So to answer your question, who do I think is a big money fight for him? Well, would it be at 170? Would it be at 185? Would he, you know, there's so many options. I think he would need a warm up fight or a fight, a winning performance to fight Lawler again. That would always be an exciting fight. There's a lot of fights. There's a lot of fights in that division, in the welterweight division, that would be exciting to see him.
And they
even in the middleweight, you know, even in middleweight.
And of course, Robbie Lawler is about to be fighting. Who do you have going into that?
Who's Robbie? Robbie fighting. I'm dropping my dropping the ball.
Woodley, he's fighting Woodley.
Oh yeah, Woodley. That's right. You know, that stylistically, that's a good matchup.
And guys, we kind of touched up on this on the last time me and Sean talked. You can check that out right here on Pure Evil MMA. We talk about this and a whole bunch of things of last week's news. You can check that out down below. We're always mixing and getting each other's ideas. So what do you think?
I would be surprised if the title changed hands, I wouldn't be shocked. I don't think it would be a shock to the world, but I do believe it's not a likely scenario simply because I feel Lawler is more battle tested, but I feel as if we've seen a lot of battle-tested fighters recently fall to the wayside, and some of it could be attributed to how battle-tested they are. And one fight comes to mind without spending too much time on it is the Diego Sanchez fight. You know, he is the epitome of battle-tested.
UFC 200, him versus Joe Lozon, that was great.
Yeah, he has been through some wars. So could we see Lawler getting knocked out by the younger fighter who hasn't been taken as much toll on his body? It wouldn't surprise me. But could I also see Woodley getting knocked out because he just doesn't have that same level of experience? He hasn't been tested the same way Lawler has? I could see that happening too. Neither one of them would significantly surprise me. And I don't want to stay on the fence. So I do believe that Lawler would continue to reign supreme.
I'm going to go with Lawler here. I mean, I have his picture right next to me, his autograph right next to me. And he's one of the most inspiring fighters, you know, how he came back and now he's champion. Yeah. We never thought we would see that. So, you know, but the question is, he's been in these battles. Is he going to be the same? I think so. I think he has what it takes to take Woodley out. It's going to be an exciting fight. I wouldn't be surprised if Woodley won, though. I wouldn't.
No, I would not be surprised. But if he was to win, it's all about if you can defend, right? It's not about if you win it. It's all about if you can defend it. And I guess that would be the real question is, with the people coming up behind Woodley, how would he rank or how would he stylistically match up to them? So if he became champion, there's a long list of people behind him waiting that would be some very challenging matchups for him.
So we're going to get into the last subject. Of course, everyone wants to know what's going on with this and get, you know, MMA correspondents' opinions about the whole Brock Lesnar thing, the John Bones thing. But first, I just want to let everyone know you can find everything you need to know about everything going on pretty much at combatsportsnation.com and also prowrestlingauthority.com. We also cover at prowrestlingauthority.com WWE, pro wrestling. I cover MMA. I'm one of three MMA correspondents over there. It's me, Ethan from London, England, and our newest member, Kate, who just wrote an amazing article about Ronda Rousey and her return and the belt, you know, playing hot potato, and definitely a great article. So check out prowrestlingauthority.com. Follow the podcast on iTunes. Just search Pro Wrestling Authority and Pure Evil MMA Podcast. Spend the morning with Evil Eddie. I know that sounds mad lame because I am Evil Eddie, but that's the commercial. That's the little voiceover. Spend your morning with Evil Eddie. But whether it's your morning commute to work, whether at the gym, going jogging, or even just tanning. It's been so hot lately. If you just want a good MMA show to listen to, check out ProWrestling30.com and Pure Evil MMA, keeping you up to date on everything MMA. We have a great time. We're always talking with everybody. Of course, we talk with Combat Sports Nation. Shout out to him. Always keeping everyone up to date. Always engaging with fans and live event updates. So check out CombatSportsNation.com and ProWrestling30.com. Let's get into it, though. Biggest news. Everyone's talking about it. Brock Lesnar. What's going on? Let everyone know what's going on.
Ah, goodness. Well, I do want, and when and if we have time at the end, hopefully we will make a little bit. I do want to acknowledge Cyborg's current situation.
Definitely. Please do. That's very important that we know what's going on with them. And I'm happy that Bellator did release a statement because we had problems with the whole data thing. That's awesome that if they did release a statement.
So the Brock Lesnar coming up dirty, am I surprised? No. Did I have my fingers crossed that it did not happen? Absolutely. Because now it's sort of, you know, of course, it's going to taint the circumstances of that fight. Regardless of what the substance was, do we know how much that substance impacted the fight? No. But in the court of public appeal, or I believe I'm saying it correctly, but it's tainted. That win is tainted, and Mark Hunt's pissed.
Mark Hunt's real pissed. He wants his whole purse,
yeah,
or he's leaving the UFC. That's huge news, and not many people are touching on this.
I wouldn't be surprised if Mark Hunt really said, I'm fucking out of here. I'm done.
Good for Mark Hunt.
It's the third fighter. It's the third fighter, Mir, Silva, and then Lesnar with Silva. Silva was actually back in action after suspension before Hunt had come back from his hand surgery, his hand injuries from their fight. So he was a little frustrated from that. Frustrated about once again in the cage, in many people's eyes, risking your health against a guy who is
performance enhancing drugs,
alleged to be cheating. You know, and I hate to use a word because everybody's like, he did cheat, but it's still.
Well, here's the thing, though. He's never been tested, and he's never failed before in the past. So, you know, I was trusting him. And what exactly was it, again, that he failed for?
What was the substance? I don't know if they actually released the substance.
They didn't release it yet. All right. They did release John Bones' June substance. That's right, though.
An estrogen blocker. Now, yes. I've never done a cycle. I know many people...
I haven't either, dude. That's all natural, man. That's all natural.
So I don't – but the reason why you would take an estrogen blocker, for those people who don't understand, it's because when you do take steroids, you – well, I see that the delay there. You're making the bicep.
Yeah.
But I – the reason why you would take an estrogen blocker is because you're adding testosterone to your body. And the testosterone, whenever your testosterone increases, your estrogen increases. So what you want to do is you want to block that estrogen so you don't get what they call bitch tits. And what happens is once your testosterone returns back to normal levels, your estrogen needs to go ahead and recalculate and go back to its normal levels. But just as you retain some of that muscle, you also retain some of what that estrogen has put into your body. And so you want to block that. So it's, yeah, he was caught for estrogen blocker. Now you got to ask him, why did you take the estrogen blocker? What is his excuse? You know, what can he really come up with a legitimate excuse?
And Chael Sonnen was talking about this on the Joe Rogan podcast, and apparently he hid under the mat for 6 hours avoiding USADA, avoiding the drug test. What's the truth behind that? Is that a real story?
It's Chael Sonnen. I mean, Chael Sonnen. How credible, you know, not to take anything away from his credibility, but many people would have to question – how much is he just adding fuel to the fire just because he has a platform to do it? Or how credible is his source, knowing that he's in the broadcast industry, and he probably does have some credible sources. But it is Chael Sonnen. He has been known to throw some stuff out there and just see what sticks. And Could I really see? I was reading that and hearing that. Could I really see the light heavyweight, the former light heavyweight champion of the world, down below, hanging out, hiding out for 6 to 8 hours? Can I really fathom company wanting to go ahead and swab where he supposedly was underneath the cage just to verify whether or not he was there? I don't know. I just think it's, as things develop, they just develop into craziness.
I thought that was funny just because, like, I was like, I think I can see him maybe doing that. But I'm glad that you touched up on the whole Chael Sonnen thing because, you know, when World Series of Fighting is coming up, we're only sitting within arm's length. So you never know if he just, you know, he's going to grab you for saying something about him. So that's good that you caught that.
That's right.
So, all right, man. John Bones Jones, you know, he's out for 2 years now, apparently. Allegedly. Is that official yet? I don't think so because they're going to be covering that this week, I'm pretty sure, at a press conference, correct?
Correct. And I won't necessarily write anything until we're able to hear directly from John Jones, or from his handlers. I don't want to say handlers, but from his people, his credible sources. Just like, you know, not to make this plug, but just like any other story, whether it's a national or a local story, regional story, we don't like to go by third parties. If a third party says something to Combat Sports Nation, we're going to go ahead and we're going to go ahead and put that, deposit that into our memory bank to where we could go ahead and approach who is it about or ask them. And then if there's some validity to it, then we'll run with the story. So if they're going to have a further or another press conference, you know, discussing it, then I'll wait until to make further assessment of what's next or my feelings on it.
And there was a funny video that my buddy Ted Check, of course, if you follow MMA, you all know who Ted is. You can find his videos on YouTube. He keeps everyone up to date on these little short videos. But apparently there was a picture of John Bones Jones at a pool when he said he was going to be flying home after he failed that test, but he was out partying at a pool. I thought that was kind of comical that they're that much up John Bones. But hey, it's media, whatever. But to be out for 2 years, everyone has been asking, is this the end of John Bones Jones?
How?
I responded the same thing. I said, there's no way. There is absolutely no way. He's still very young. But the saddest part is that we've given him so many chances, and he just made his return. He just fought OSP. He failed out of the UFC 200, and of course the Brock Lesnar thing, you know, he failed. So that was almost just a complete mess. UFC 200 was almost a complete mess. And Mark Hunt is really speaking up about it, and that's what we got in this conversation talking about. Do you think that he should get the $2.5 million, or at least half, getting back into Mark Hunt versus Brock Lesnar, USADA, drug testing conversation?
Logistically, I mean, legally, how would that even work? I mean, what type of shitstorm would that stir up with other fighters who say, hey, I've been in the same situation. I fought guys who have been popped for steroids. Where was I compensated? Where was I able to get a portion of?
That's a great point.
So, now, has this happened to another fighter three times? No, I don't believe so. Does Hunt have some footing to go on? Absolutely. If Lesnar is fined, where should that money go to? Well, I believe fines go to the commission. Is the commission likely, or goes to the promotion? Are they likely to go ahead and pay out money to Hunt? I don't know. Should he get? It's really hard. Should he get something? I mean, is it a shitty situation and he should get something? Is it just emotion right now? I don't know. I mean, that's a great question for some of the listeners. What should happen? you know. But just as he could have been champion and reigned supreme as champion in the UFC if he decided to bail and, you know, stuck his finger up and said, fuck you guys, I'm going somewhere else. I believe he could. I believe anybody would be of a value. He would be of value to any promotion he decided to go to, and he would get paid.
Dude, I'm so happy that he's speaking up. I am happy he's speaking up, and that is his argument. That has this really happened to anyone three times? Like, come on. That's a great argument to be, you know. And I love that you brought that up. That's why I love going to Combat Sports Nation and seeing what you think about this. So thank you so much for coming on the show, because I always love hearing what you have to think about it. You actually take a different approach and really break it down, and makes me think differently about the situation at hand, you know. And as an MMA correspondent, you really got to keep your mind open. You can't be biased, and you do a great job at that, man.
I appreciate that. I very much do. The biggest way is, it's not necessarily the way you ask the question or you think about the situation it's about how you're interpreting the situation. And I like to try to get the people to think a little bit differently. And when I say that, I want people to understand we don't do clickbait. We won't go ahead and throw out a title and hope you click on it, which the title has absolutely nothing to do with the content inside the story. But our titles, our content, it is there with facts behind them, but to give you a different perspective of the situation than maybe most.
Really important. It's very important that you do that.
It is. And one thing, you know, and I don't know if you were going to segue to it, but I don't want to go without acknowledging one more thing regarding. And one thing I actually will say, I love being on this podcast, Evil Eddie podcast.
Pure Evil MMA.
Because it's like none other. It's very easy. It's very comfortable just to sort of shoot the shit and throw out our ideas. I might stumble over my words, and that just sort of brings down the hey, we're some journalists who are just very, very passionate about fights or the fight community. So I really enjoy being a part of this. So I greatly appreciate you having me. With that being said, one last thing that I do want to touch on is the dark side of MMA had reared its, you know, no pun intended, but its ugly head this past weekend at Bellator with the injury to Cyborg. And, I just feel as if that is just as scary as a broken orbital bone, which is we see often. But the gruesome images of Cyborg Santos's skull fracture, it really hits me. It really, really does hits me emotionally, because we watched a guy's career end. I would really doubt that he will ever. Now, am I putting a hex on him? I definitely don't believe I am. I think I'm speaking the truth. I don't believe, and I don't take any. I don't put any fault on Michael Page for his technique or for what he had done. I believe that we saw the end of. I believe we saw the end of Cyborg this past weekend, and
so sad. That's true.
It is sad, and I don't think it's far from the truth.
Everyone who doesn't know what's going on, Michael Venom Page just fought Cyborg this weekend, and he did a flying knee, and it cracked his forehead right here. There's literally a dent in it, and I'm pretty sure what you're trying to say is they released a statement on it. Is that what happened? They released a statement on his condition right now?
Well, yeah, I mean, let me not paraphrase. Let me just go straight over to Combat Sports Nation, and then I'll pull up, which I will say the original release was through MMA Junkie, which I did link in my story. That's one thing that I always make sure I do. As a journalist, you want to always make sure you're citing your sources. A lot of times I'm just releasing the press releases as I receive them, but I always, always cite the sources. Unfortunately, I see it too often that companies will go ahead and blast out press releases as if it was their own, and they don't cite where they originally got the information from, and it's very disappointing. So I did go ahead and cite the source, which was MMA Junkie. They originally reported the statement, but the statement was as follows. Let's see.
And just before you get into that, just before you read that, this is very important that they let everyone know how this fighter is doing, because it's not just a show, guys. This is someone's life.
Yeah.
Has a family. His career could be ending. That's what he relies on for money. And that's a huge problem about being a fighter is, like, what do you do afterwards? And we see this time and time again, like, where are they now? So I really hope that he is all right, and I really hope this isn't true. But I'm very happy that Bellator did release a statement, because we did have problems with this in the past when Dada and Kimbo fought. We couldn't really get them to tell us what was going on. But, you know, they're making changes. That's good to see. What does that statement say?
So, I'm just going to tell you a little bit. A short paragraph of it. If you want to go to Combat Sports Nation, you can go ahead and read a little bit more about the GoFundMe page. It's got the link there. It's got.
And where can everybody find you on Twitter before you do say that, so they can find this?
It's CMBTSPRTS Nation on Twitter. It is in my feed. You can also go on Facebook. It's in the feed there as well. I could link it to this, to the podcast once the live stream is done. But I was able to put it up in one article. I summed it up. You know, I really put it in there to where it shows how it happened. It shows the damage while Santos is there inside the hospital, both the x-ray and him sitting in the hospital.
Yeah, I saw that. Yep.
Originally posted on Chris Cyborg's his ex-wife's Instagram, and then I also put up in that same article. The article was where it really put together to it's sort of a one-stop a link of what everything had happened, including Michael Page's expression of how he wished the best for his fallen opponent's family and his health. And he also made a contribution
to the GoFundMe
and blasted out the GoFundMe.
I was about to ask you if you put that on your page.
I did put it on there, and there was, hands down, is the management company for Michael Page, and one of the largest contributions to the GoFundMe was $500 from Hands Down. And I can only assume that was the actual management company of Michael Page. So he's doing his part. Everything counts. I mean, don't think it sounds, it might sound cliche, but even if it's a $5 contribution.
He has children to feed, he has bills to pay, and he put on this show for everyone to entertain us.
Yeah, and we're talking about a guy who risks his livelihood to do something that he loves for the cheers of the fans. So now all we're asking is the fans is to do their part and to show your appreciation of him putting his life on the line. I mean, look. This isn't over. I mean, this guy is hoping that he can leave and go to Brazil to further get this injury taken care of, but he can't even fly. So who knows? You know, you have that machine to where you clean it up, and then it starts to act up. You know, who knows if once they start to repair the skull fracture, what is it going to do? What is that fracture really? Is it holding anything in place to where if it's moved, there's brain damage, who knows?
And we have so many questions. So if anyone wants to find out any further information, make sure you head over to combatsportsnation.com, and there'll be all the links, everything that you need to know. Please help Cyborg out. He puts this on for us to be entertained. So thank you so much for bringing that up. That's very important, because these are real people. They're not just in the box like we're in the box. They are real people that dedicate their life for the sport. And it's a hard to make a living after your prime, really. You know, it's just in your 20s, 30s. You know, it's hard. So thank you for coming on the show and letting us know that. To review everything that happened on the show, in case you tuned in late, this is where we're pretty much going to wrap everything up. I just want to let everyone know what this episode was about and what you might have missed if you tuned in late. We covered the Bellator. We covered Brock Lesnar. We covered John Bones Jones. We covered Holly. What else did we cover? We talked about a lot going on in MMA, the Bellator, what Bellator can do to put on better shows, lion fights, World Series of Fighting. We covered it all, man, every square inch. So thank you so much for coming on. I'm Evil Eddie from Pure Evil MMA and ProWrestlingAuthority.com. Just to correct everyone, you were saying this is the podcast, but this is actually a webisode for Pure Evil MMA. Right. The podcast, guys, is on iTunes and Podbean.com. So make sure to head over to iTunes, and if you don't have an Apple, that's fine. You might have a Droid, so just go to Podbean.com and search Pro Wrestling Authority, Pure Evil MMA. Is right there every week, keeping you up to date. I'm always trying to, like you were saying, just keep it comfortable. Just hang out, get updated on all your news, discuss, different ideas. So whether you're waking up, morning commute, you're at the gym, jogging, tanning, Pure Evil MMA, ProWrestlingAuthority.com, CombatSportsNation.com. Thank you so much for dropping by. One more time, though, you can find me on Twitter at evil_echo. That's EVIL_ECCO. Subscribe down below. Can you give everyone where your tags are really quick?
Yeah, again, it's Combat Sports Nation on Facebook. It's combatsportsnation.com. It is also Combat Sports Nation on YouTube, in addition to our Twitter, which it is growing. CMBTSPRTS. Nation. We update most events. If we're not updating, Evil Eddie is definitely updating. And we appreciate everybody's support. There is one thing, Eddie, that you don't mention. Eddie recently started a Facebook page. I want to go ahead. Twitter is a great tool to be able to go ahead and get all information immediately. But his Facebook page is really going to be able to provide you with his content. I
forgot about that, man. Yeah, I just started that.
So if you want to read how he perceives things, absolutely go to Twitter. He's very active there. I'll plug you there. But also his Facebook page is where you're going to be able to find a lot of his links, a lot of these podcasts, a lot of these episodes.
To find it all between my Twitter links, the videos, everything meets right there on Facebook for everybody. And the same with you. You have a like page as well for everyone to check out.
Yes. If I could quickly say something about I don't want to spend too much time. I was going to go ahead and post something. I think I will still post something today. Last weekend at International Fight Week, we hit 4,000 likes, which to me, it's a very big deal. Dude, that's 4,000 likes in 2 years, July 17th. So what's that? What's today, the 18th?
Today is the 18th.
So yesterday, we had our Facebook page for 2 years. And understand that I have never paid for a like for our Facebook page. That is all organic. I have never asked. I don't have numerous admins on my page to where I had asked, hey, can you just invite your whole friends list?
And I didn't even know you can do that. That's crazy. And that's very important that these are all, you know, people who are active following, you know.
And they're engaged. And that's the thing. You know, understand that there are some sites out there that show a number on their like page of 20,000 or 25,000 or 15,000, which Combat Sports Nation, we could do that. We could definitely do that. And again, we could do that by asking my 2,000 plus friends on Facebook, hey, could you go ahead and invite your friends list? That is not my goal. My goal is to get people who are engaged. I want, if you're going to invite people to follow Combat Sports Nation on Facebook, which we get our most notoriety, where we get our most traffic, invite your fellow fight fans. A couple people, real quick, Matt Bassett, Aaron Lamont, Aaron Cooney, who is now Aaron Lamont. She's been married to Casey Lamont for a long time now. Divine Estes. These are just a few of the very few people I have ever asked to go ahead and help out and throw some invites towards Combat Sports Nation, and we appreciate that. But other than that, man, it was grown by getting your face out there. If you want to build a brand, not necessarily you, because you're doing a phenomenal job, because you're understanding that you need to get your face, your brand out to the public. That's how you build it. That is the right way. When you want to go to get sponsors, or you want to show people we are legitimate, they want to see how many people are engaged. They want to see what are your real numbers pulling. And if you're just purchasing your likes, or you just have big inflated numbers because you just have everybody and their grandmother like your page just to like it, you're really hurting yourself. So we're proud. We're very excited where we are. 2 years in our Facebook page. And then we're approaching 2 years coming up with our website. So
congratulations, man. That's awesome. And guys, also, you know, like I said, all the media, it meets right on Facebook at Pure Evil MMA. So like that, Combat Sports Nation. And me and Sean, we talk with other MMA correspondents as well. So in those posts, if you just click the comments, you can see me and Sean interacting with one another. So if you guys see that and have anything to say, you know, give us your opinion on it, and we're always right back. Quick response time, always by our phone through MMA correspondents. We're here for you guys to talk MMA. Anything that you guys need to know, ask us. That's what we're here for. We're here for you guys, and it's very important that, you know, we just want to let you guys know what's going on in the world. It's very exciting, and MMA, it's going down right now. So definitely get involved. Thank you for coming on today's show. I'm Evil Eddie from Pure Evil MMA and ProWrestling30.com. Check it out. We're out, guys. Have a good one.
Thank you so much. I appreciate the time.